Hello? Dr. Aloha, William Herschel speaking. I'm calling to confirm the message you sent us yesterday. Professor Herschel, I'm sorry to bother you and the rest of the council with such trivialities, but I have to follow the rules. I know this report cannot be right. At first I just thought one of the junior observers made a mistake, but then it kept appearing on our telescopes, so it seems it's just an equipment malfunction. Nothing serious, I hope, but we can't really replace...
Enough, Doctor. I've been reading similar reports from our posts in Jagungal, Kilimanjaro and Mount Whitney. I've also received some unofficial confirmations from our Commonwealth counterparts in Goldhoppingen, Fuji and Elbrus. They all confirm the same thing your assistant saw. This is no malfunction, Doctor. It's real. But if this is real, then that means... We both know what this means, Doctor. There's no need to say it out loud over an unsecured line. But still, I had to call to confirm it.
I see. So what are we going to do about it?
I don't know if we can do anything about it, but we'll have to try. The annual Amsterdam summit will be held next week. The rest of the council and I are planning to go there and present our findings to all sides.
But this is strategic information, Professor. Her Majesty's Parliament will not be happy if you'll just spill it out in front of the entire world.
This is not an information we can just omit and keep to ourselves, Doctor. We can't alienate those who could potentially help us solve this situation. If we want to get through this, we'll have to work together. Queen's orders be damned.
I understand, but what do you think our chances are, even with their help?
None. But that way, maybe we'll at least die united.
In 2019, humanity received its death sentence, though at the time nobody seemed to understand it. It began quietly with a lone report from a remote observatory in South America, a report that spoke of a stellar object, most likely extrasolar in origin, that was spotted passing near Neptune. Initially dismissed, believed to have been caused by faulty equipment, the report was soon repeated by other observatories across the globe, and as more eyes turned to observe this visitor to the solar system, they uncovered its terrifying secret. This object, this planetoid roughly three-quarters the size of Earth's moon, was on direct collision course with humanity's homeworld. At first, the scientists around the world couldn't believe it, but after months of running every possible simulation, the conclusion remained the same. In 6 years, planet Earth, and all living organisms it houses, would be eradicated. Even if the planetoid would miss Earth, its gravitational pull would still be strong enough to alter Blue Planet's orbit, causing it to spiral into the cold void of space, or into fiery embrace of the Sun. The doomsday clock has been set, and the people of the world had to be warned, if only to prepare for the inevitable. And so, top members of Royal Astronomical Society banded together with scientists from across the nations of Commonwealth for the first time since the moon landing, and together they travelled to annual Amsterdam summit, neutral place where Earth's superpowers could solve their differences without resorting to violence, and preached for unity in face of impending catastrophe. But as always, there was no unity in Amsterdam. Only thinly veiled aggression just waiting to be unleashed. The summit was first organized after the Great War to ensure that Commonwealth and Empire could sort their differences without millions of casualties across the world, but after 3 centuries of bitter rivalry, half of which spent in active war, diplomacy had little chance to overcome the deeply lodged resentment between two giants. Especially since burned-out, irradiated ruins of Warsaw and London still provided both sides with enough reasons to hate each other. So instead of cooperation they hoped for, astronomers witnessed a tide of aggression. Both sides accused each other of falsifying the report about the planetoid, claiming that a side that would focus its efforts on preventing the catastrophe would be distracted enough for the other one to strike. The overarching threat to humanity was ignored in favor of power play rivalry, and another war loomed in the air. But in their desperation, the astronomers decided to bypass bickering politicians and appeal directly to the masses across the world. Breaking the rule of the summit, that stated that no message can be released to the public without approval of at least 3/4 of attendees, Chief of Royal Astronomical Society and Director of Commonwealth Stellar Institute sent a warning on every possible channel, even into most remote corners of the world. And though they were arrested and detained as traitors by their respective governments, their message had the desired effect. While politicians argued on the summit, enough people around the world realized the threat the planetoid posed and vocally demanded action. Unwilling to face riots that would destabilize their nations, diplomats backed down and agreed to sign a pact of non-aggression, at least until the crisis has passed. But that was it. The war has been averted, but there would be no cooperation. Both sides of the barricade would try to save themselves on their own. The borders were closed, the diplomatic channels cut, and one of the darkest ages in human history had begun. An age where humanity, plagued by constant failures and encroaching end, spiraled more and more into barbarism and chaos. Great many plans to save humanity have been drafted during these 6 years. Some possible, some not, some beyond even the wildest imagination of science fiction writers. But all those plans had one thing in common. They failed. Imperial plan to blast the planetoid to bits by drilling into its surface and detonating nuclear warheads failed when the ship they sent missed its landing vector by a fraction of a degree and flew into dark space, taking its crew of 200 people and 500 nukes into the void. Commonwealth's plan to build a colony on the moon failed when the arcology they built collapsed in a cave-in, burying hundreds of walkers and material worth billions under tons of lunar rock. The United Provinces had more luck. Their underwater city, built in the deepest reaches of Mariana Trench, proved self-sufficient enough to house thousands of people, until it just vanished without a trace overnight, 3 years before the end. Each of these failures meant loss of men, resources, and most importantly, time. Time that humanity didn't have. And with every failure, the efforts to save mankind from extinction grew more and more desperate, and soon shifted from saving as many individuals as possible to simply preserving the race, in hopes of starting again somewhere else. But those plans too had failed. Deep underground bunkers built by Empire collapsed when mining crews drilled through to magma layer. The generation ship sent towards Alpha Centauri by the Commonwealth suffered critical life support failure mere days after leaving Earth's atmosphere, turning it into a steel and polymer tomb of 2,000 people pointed at a distant sun. The provinces saw some limited success in their final efforts. As a last resort, they sent a ship to Mars with 100 people on board, 50 men and 50 women. But those people wouldn't go there as colonists. Instead, they were all preserved in cryogenic hibernation. There was only one issue. No one, at the time, knew if the hibernation would even work, let alone how to wake those people from their frozen slumber. The ship that was sent, essentially a giant floating nuclear reactor, had enough power to keep its occupants in cryosleep for over 2,000 years, but unless they were found by some outside power, one far more technologically advanced than humanity, with tools to wake up the preserved humans, it would be nothing more but yet another tomb, whose inhabitants would spend 2 millennia unconscious, only to have their death sentence delayed. As such, the ship was outfitted with the greatest communications array known to man, its sole purpose to send a distress signal in all directions across the galaxy, hoping someone would listen. But in the end, this plan was nothing but humanity's last shout into the void, a prayer to cold, uncaring universe made against all odds. But the vacuum of space absorbs all sounds, and so the prayers remained unanswered. It was 11 months left on the clock when the cryo ship left for Mars with its hopeless mission, and with its passing, Earth grew darker with every day, as hope waned, and mankind fell deeper into chaos and despair. Nations were shaken by riots as people had nothing left to lose. Decadence and barbarism gripped the world on an unprecedented scale, and in most places, order became just a distant memory of a time where there was hope. That is until another catastrophe happened. One that, initially, seemed like yet another insult thrown by the uncaring world, but in the end, it turned out to be the single most important event that happened in recorded history. It began with an earthquake. As the planetoid drew closer to Earth, the effects of its arrival were felt all across the planet. Tides shifted, causing floods and climate anomalies. The orbits of Earth and Moon shifted, and even tectonic plates moved as if trying to escape the doomed world. And one of those sudden tectonic movements torn one of Commonwealth's capitals, Istanbul, out of its roots and plunged the city into the depths below. It was there and then, in the fallout of one of the greatest catastrophes known to man, when hope was rekindled for the final time. For although the city disappeared underground, the massive cave-in unearthed something else, a massive, formerly underground vault made out of unknown metal. Bewildered by this discovery, rescue crews decided to contact the few remaining science institutions that still operated across Commonwealth, and over the next 2 weeks they worked to get the vault open. When they finally did, they were rewarded by something even stranger, a portal-like device attached to impossibly complicated machinery that, according to researchers' observations, seemed to draw power directly from the planetary core. Initially dormant, as soon as the rescue crews and scientists entered the vault, the machinery sprang to life and the portal opened. At first, scientists and miners backed away in terror. After all, they just witnessed an unknown device that, for all they knew, was inactive for ages,
and yet restarted within few seconds, but after a few days of careful observation, the vault was deemed safe, and analysis of the strange object could finally begin. It was also at this time when Commonwealth's Assembly, what remained of it, was informed about the discovery. Soon, politicians and top government scientists arrived in ruins of Istanbul, all asking the same question: could this mysterious gateway save humanity? Unfortunately, answering that question proved more difficult than it seemed. First was the problem of categorization. What if this device looked like a portal to us while being something else altogether? There was no trace of original creators, who might have thought in a very different manner after all. Second problem was more practical. If the device really was a gateway, the question was, where does it lead to? Aside from the core reactor and the portal, the vault held no clues as to what could await on the other side. And that led to a third problem. The machine worked, of that there was no doubt, but every single object, be it a piece of rock, a remote scout robot or an animal, that passed through the gateway never returned. The scientists were deadlocked, until one night, with just 7 months left on the doomsday clock, a Lithuanian engineer from University of Gardinas grabbed a backpack full of food and supplies and snuck through the cordon of Commonwealth soldiers guarding the device. Then, in his final moments on Earth, he screamed at the politicians who were camped just beside the cordon. "If I have to die," he shouted, "then it will be on my own terms." And with that, he stepped into the portal. Once more, panic gripped leaders of political team, but it seemed that this engineer's action broke most of the scientists out of their stupor. Some of them used the confusion and rushed the portal themselves. Others vocally demanded the military cordon to be removed, so anyone could decide their own fate. But it was one calm action of delegation from University of Beijing that truly broke the stalemate. The Chinese scholars reasoned that the engineer was right. If staying here on Earth meant certain death, then taking a chance, no matter how small, with the portal was a preferred alternative. And to get their point across, they recorded a short message detailing the discovery of the gateway and painting it as humanity's only hope for salvation. Then, they hijacked access to one of Commonwealth's satellites and threatened to broadcast the message to the whole world. The Assembly was given a choice: either recognize the portal as the only chance of survival and organize an official evacuation, or risk complete chaos as masses would try to reach the gateway on their own. And so, it was a reckless action of one desperate man and technical aptitude of his peers that started the Exodus. But even that last chapter of Earth's history was plagued by mistakes and failures. At first, problems were purely logistical. With just a few months left until the end, and with collapse of societies across the world, simply spreading the message across to the populace proved to be challenging, not to mention organizing worldwide evacuation. Second problem was the message itself. When Commonwealth's remaining leaders sent their warning to the world, they painted it as a mere untested chance of survival. They explained, in great detail, that no one knew just what awaited humanity on the other side, as nothing returned from the portal after entering it. As such, many people ignored this message, out of fear, out of hopelessness, or out of myriad other reasons. But still, many flocked to Istanbul ruins in order to enter the gateway in hope of escaping certain doom. And that's when a third problem manifested. As exiles of fallen Earth marched towards the portal, they realized that people waiting in line were only of Commonwealth's origin, and some began asking questions about citizens of United Empire, but their questions were ignored. And so, a group of altruistically minded citizens, or Imperial spies depending on reports, somehow managed to contact Imperial government and asked about their absence. The reaction they got was confusion. United Empire had no idea about the gateway, as if the information was withheld from them. The court's reaction was swift. Empress Victoria VIII ordered mass mobilization of every Imperial citizen. They were to rush towards Istanbul and save themselves, while all across the border, Imperial armies would carve a path towards Turkish capital, trying to open corridors for more civilians. So, as the final countdown began, Earth was once again darkened by flames of war. Perhaps the weirdest war it had ever seen. Realizing that their time is limited, Imperial armies overextended themselves in their blitz towards Istanbul, leaving them open to Commonwealth's counterattacks, but those never happened, for armies of the East were unwilling to face enemies far away from the gateway that could be their only salvation. Soon, all military action concentrated in area around old Turkish capital, with civilians from both sides trapped in between, desperately trying to move through crossfire and reach the ruins. Tens of thousands died each day, but in the end, armies of the Commonwealth managed to hold their ground, until finally the doomsday came, and soldiers and civilians alike forgot their animosities, dropped all they carried, and stormed towards the gateway. We have very little reports from this last day. We know that the sky was glowing bright red, same as every day of the final month. We know that gravitational and magnetic forces of the planetoid wreaked havoc on weather, as well as all high-tech electronic equipment. Planes fell from the sky, tornadoes ravaged the land, lightning struck every second, causing fires all across the world. And between all that, a writhing mass of people trampled each other to reach the chance of safety. In that crowd, a young girl from the mountains of Caucasus lost sight of her family, and the crowd carried her along towards the gateway. And as she neared it, everything suddenly went quiet. The sky bursted with light as the planetoid struck the Earth out of line of sight, thousands of kilometers away. In the next second, the world started to tremble. The girl pushed herself forwards and upwards, fear giving her strength, and lunged towards the portal, the shockwave already closing in behind her. Then darkness. Then, an explosion of light and sound and pain and cold. All at once, her senses came back to life and she curled into a ball, terrified of what awaited her on the other side. But as she lied there, she heard a voice. A voice she heard so many times on her way here, in the message that encouraged her to flee. Voice of one reckless Lithuanian engineer, the first exile. And it said, "You can open your eyes, kid. You'll be safe here." She did as the voice said, still uncertain of her fate, and witnessed, with shock all other exiles felt, the world that lied on the other side. A windswept mountain valley stretched before her eyes, not so different from the one she spent most of her life in. At the bottom of the valley, safe from freezing winds that blew in her face, a line of exiles formed in front of a rapidly growing town, carved into the mountainside. And when she looked to the skies, she saw there an ominous red orb, a sure sign of leaving Earth behind. Overwhelmed with relief, she embraced the first exile, but her joy was short-lived, as she realized that, aside from howling of the wind, they stood there in absolute silence. No exile came through the gateway after her, and the device, which was humming with energy just a minute ago, was now silent. The casualty report was staggering. Approximately 9 billion people lived on Earth before the cataclysm. Of those 9 billion, less than one managed to get through the portal, and in the chaos that followed, millions more have lost their lives, mostly to elements and starvation. For although the world humanity escaped to was habitable, it was far less than welcoming. An entire planet of freezing, arid mountains, frozen lakes, and almost no vegetation. The scientists and agriculturalists set out to work immediately to provide sustenance to Earth's refugees, but the truth was unforgiving. There simply wasn't enough food and shelter for everyone. And so, as days passed, the number of dead rose. Soon, in order to prevent chaos, the refugees were split into hundreds of groups and marched on into the wilds, hoping to find something that could help them survive. Some groups succeeded. They found vast networks of caves, heated by geothermal vents and full of edible vegetation. Others would encounter hardy local wildlife that could be hunted or domesticated. But others would march into the unknown and disappear forever. But in the end, a few years later, the decline would finally end. The population would stabilize, then grow again, as scattered colonies began to adapt to a new environment. And finally, 21 years after the last exile arrived through the portal, the colonies reunited. In honor of their rising despite all odds, the planet they now inhabited was named Ortus, meaning rising in Latin, and the star that shone above the exiles as they rebuilt their lives was named Asha, meaning hope in Hindi. Thus, humanity rose again, and a light of hope shone brightly upon their future. My fellow citizens, you are that hope. You are that future. Ever since our ancestors came through the gateway, they grieved. They grieved for their lost home, their lost families, their lost lives. Then they teach this grief to their children, and though they have never seen Earth in their lives, they wept for it, ashamed of being born under a different sun. They listened to tales that glorified people of the blue planet, as if they deserved praise. And for decades we have placed on the pedestal those who, in the time of need, not only failed themselves, but everyone around them, and doomed their world. For how else could you call the Exodus if not a failure? Our ancestors received their first warning in 2019, exactly 5 decades after their ancestors landed on the moon, 3 decades after they landed on Mars, and almost a decade after first man set foot on Titan. The means to save humanity were there, and yet they were squandered, as people of Earth lived in the past and brawled in pointless rivalries that began in the age of gunpowder. Even as their very home was threatened with total annihilation, these centuries-old grudges took precedent over logic and reason, and in the end, when they needed to unite, they fought each other to the very end. That they were saved was nothing more than a blind stroke of luck, but that wasn't the end. Instead of starting anew, the Exiles brought their grudges and their anger and their grief for sins of previous centuries with them. Then, they teach that grief to their children, who knew nothing of it, and they teach it to their children, and generation after generation lived their lives in the past, disdaining the present. But thankfully, not all of them. While the last Exile grieved for her family, the first Exile explored. While the last Exile held vigils around the destroyed gateway, the first Exile built. And the last Exile and her followers despised the planet that gave them shelter and threw curses into the sky, the first Exile and his people rebuilt the civilization and dragged humanity forward. Always a minority, they worked as hard as they could, knowing that if they lose their hope, there will be none left. But today, almost 2 centuries after the Exodus, that has finally changed, and you, my fellow citizens, are the proof of that change. 10 years ago, you have proved that we have grieved enough, that we are ready to finally shake off that despair that gripped our people for nearly 200 years. 10 years ago, your votes finally removed the Exile Party from the position of power in the Council and placed us, the Innovation Party, at the helm. Except we are not above you, we are among you, the scientists, the workers, explorers and settlers. You have placed great trust in us, and in the name of all those people I want to say, I'm deeply honored with that trust. But today, I'm more than honored. I'm humbled, for you have trusted us for the second time. It is a proof, I hope, that our course is set, that we will let go of the past and go forward together. And so, with the votes counted and the Council elected for another decade, it is my honor to announce a project we've been working on during this last term. My fellow citizens, behold, the Expanse Project. Our ancestors had the means to flee their world, and they failed to use them. We will not repeat their mistakes. As I speak these words, hundreds of rockets are launching all across the globe with one goal in mind. They will carry men and material needed to build humanity's first permanent habitat in space. But that will be just the first step. With rapid advances in technology for the first time in history, we are in position to become an interplanetary species. With the spaceport built, we'll be able to construct science vessels and send explorers to chart the planets of our system. We will bring their riches home, and in time we will learn how to master their environments and turn them into new homes. And one day, perhaps sooner than we might expect, we will travel to other stars as well, bringing hope with us. My fellow citizens, today, in the name of entire humanity, I have the honor of proclaiming that space age has finally begun. For too long we've been held back, by our past, by our differences, and by our homeworld itself. It is finally time to spread our wings and soar, like eagles our ancestors claimed as their sigil. We have been given a second chance, let us not squander it. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Second Chance, a narrative let's play for Stellaris, in which we'll be guiding new humanity almost 200 years after our original homeworld of Earth was destroyed in a cataclysm, and only a fraction of its population managed to escape. But this is all in the past, and we have far more important things to do right now. As you heard in the prologue, we join humanity in a very important moment. For the first time, we have sufficient technology to build a permanent, life-supporting habitat in space. And thanks to our government, the Innovation Party of Autos Council of Nations, that is exactly what we are doing right now. Our entire race is working on this single project, but this is only a first step. Once we have a spaceport ready, we'll be able to use it to build first real spaceships. Not rockets or probes we used in the past to scan our new home system, but actual spaceships that won't have to deal with gravitational pull of stars and planets, allowing us to traverse our entire star system in matters of weeks instead of years. And most importantly, our scientists are confident that they are on the verge of massive breakthrough that could even give us an opportunity to travel to other stars and explore them as well. But for now, this is all just in planning phase. Until we build that spaceport, we won't be able to really do anything, so while we wait for the construction to finish, let us take a look at the situation we're in. First, let's examine our environments. Humanity's new home is Ortis, an Antarctic-type planet orbiting a very cold and very dark, though extremely bright in infrared, L-class dwarf star named Asha. Now, L-class stars are rather rare, but finding one that has enough mass to actually support fusion is even less common, so we got extremely lucky there, because if Asha was even a tiny bit smaller, it would have been a brown dwarf, and Ortis probably wouldn't be habitable at all. Now, speaking of Ortis, it's the only planet in our system that, from what we know so far, supports life, despite being an extremely cold, dry, mountainous wasteland. Aside from that, the rest of planets in our system are basically what you could expect from a cold system. A couple of gas giants, some asteroids here and there hinting at a planet that might have existed in their place ages ago, and a bunch of cold, atmosphere-less barren rocks, floating quietly through the void. Some of them are frozen, some are scorching hot, some have noticeable volcanic activity, while some are covered in what seem like toxic vapors, similar to Venus in our old solar system. So, they are nothing special, but the Council believes that we'll find enough interesting things out there, be it materials or knowledge, that it will justify the cost of this entire space exploration project. There's also one thing that is kind of new to our people. When they were on the surface of Ortis, planet's atmosphere and frequent cloud cover distorted the light of our star into something relatively familiar. But now, as more and more people leave the atmosphere for their posts in orbit, they begin to realize that our system, with its very dark sun and crimson nebula in the background, looks kinda sinister, as everything is tinted hellish red. Now, of course, this is simply nature at work, but it doesn't change the fact that some might consider it a bad omen. Let's hope they're wrong. Alright, so we looked at our planetary neighborhood, so now let's focus on the people who inhabit it. We are, not a surprise, humans. In theory, the same species that lived on Earth, but you have to consider passage of time. The Exodus happened 175 years ago, in 2025, and now we had several generations who were born here on Ortis, and as such they adapted to their new environments. But first, let's take a look at the one thing that our current population has in common with their ancestors. The majority of the people who fled through Gateway were of Commonwealth origin, and since Commonwealth was, among other things, home of Industrial Revolution, its entrepreneurial spirit is still strong in our people. Basically, people of Ortis have this idea, deeply rooted in their heads, that the best way to deal with a problem is to build your way out of it, and this industrialist mentality should help us expand in far more efficient manner. So, that's the one thing people of Old Earth would easily recognize, but other than that, humanity changed quite significantly during these last centuries. First, most obvious thing that's different is a severe agoraphobia, present in almost every single individual of our race. See, because surface of Ortis isn't exactly pleasant, with its freezing temperatures, the exiles were forced to build extensive shelters in order to survive. Now, building shelters for millions of people before establishing industry is downright impossible, but thankfully Ortis had one more surprise in store. The entire planet is full of caves, big and small, that form an entire underground network of tunnels. Tunnels that people from Earth used as shelters, since they were full of edible, if a bit gross, vegetation. And, most importantly, because of geothermal activity, they were able to live there without freezing to death within a minute. So, the majority of our race went underground, and even those who stayed above rarely left their shelters. If they needed more space, they preferred to expand them instead of trying to survive the cold. And only hunters and cattle breeders stayed under the sky. But that, as you might expect, had its downsides. While we've adapted to living underground, and as time progressed we built more and more cities above ground, though still kept a roof between ourselves and the sky, we are now at this point where our people can't walk in the open without stressing out. So not only this will reduce our food production, since farming still is mostly an outdoor activity, but it will also make it harder for us to adapt to different environments, at least until we dig enough holes in the ground to hide ourselves. But there was another thing in Ortis Caves, one that had even more impact on our biology than never seeing the sun. While first pioneers explored said caves, they found several edible plants and fungi, and adapted them into their diet. But what they didn't know was that these cave crops were home to a tiny little microbe that, when ingested, formed a symbiotic relationship with the host. It multiplied in various internal organs, and at first was considered to be dangerous, but after some testing, early science teams reached an unbelievable conclusion. The microbe formed a thin, protective layer around its host cells, slowing down aging processes, increasing natural lifespan up to 20 years. Still, there was a downside to it as well. While the microbes' effects were positive, they had one side effect. Slowing down aging also meant slowing down the growing and forming of new organisms, fetuses to be precise. Thus, pregnancies are no longer regular 9-month affairs and can take up to a full year. increasing the risks of complications. Of course, we now have enough medical knowledge to make sure those complications are dealt with swiftly and efficiently, but it still means our population growth is reduced, so perhaps in the future we'll have to find a way to remedy that. At any rate, that single microbe and its effects on humanity sparked a certain excitement among the pioneers, and many of them dedicated their lives to studying the biology of their new home. After all, if one microorganism could prolong our lives by 2 decades, maybe we could find something that could extend them even further. That excitement holds to this very day, with schools and universities focusing mostly on various biological studies. And whenever you study living organisms, you also study various connections between them, leading to simultaneous increase of sociological studies. In short, we not only want to dissect newly encountered life forms, but we also want to figure out what makes them tick, and, if we're lucky, if we could use that knowledge for our own benefit. All of those factors, living underground, eating cave fungus, and having symbiotic microorganisms inside our bodies, means that our natural human adaptability has receded somewhat. Because unlike Earth, Ortus is a single biome planet, and a very specific biome at that. Think of it like this. Imagine being born on, say, Greenland, which is not only a very cold location, but also very dry. The biosphere in such place will, understandably, be very limited, and without much diversity. You won't find massive trees or million species of insects, no, you will finding some hardy moss and large mammals. And now imagine that you lived there for 50 years and were suddenly transported right into the middle of tropical jungle, preferably during monsoon season. Not only you'd be constantly exhausted from heat and humidity, but the local flora and fauna would completely overload your internal sensors, and you would soon drown in your own sweat in the middle of rancid, fetid jungle. So, considering we have lived on Ortus for several generations, our species developed a certain kind of biophobia, and as such we will have to put more effort if we ever want to colonize other planets. Not too good, especially combined with already mentioned agoraphobia. So, that's our biological and genetic background covered, but let us focus on the people themselves, specifically on what kind of society they had formed here, far, far away from home. First and foremost, we are democratic people. As already mentioned, most of our original population came from the Commonwealth, home of democracy, a nation that formed in early 18th century by overthrowing its impotent king and regime of decadent nobility. And not only Commonwealth managed to defend its independence from various other monarchies who tried to put it down, but it managed to grow and prosper, and in early 21st century, it united dozens of nations from lands of Germany in the west to Japan in the east. So, that legacy means we're used to the form of government where our population has a ward in running of the state, and in fact over the last few years, ever since the Innovation Party came to power over a decade ago, our system has evolved into something with even more hands-on approach, but we'll talk more about that later. Secondly, whenever our people encounter a problem, they try to resolve it by applying reason, hard evidence and logic, instead of impulsively following emotions. This, again, has its roots in Commonwealth of old, as, after the Revolution of 1701, a drastic shift was necessary in order for the revolutionaries to stay alive. Traditional thinking, both in peace and in war, was not enough, and young Commonwealth had to forcibly modernize in order to keep its independence. The Founding Fathers used every opportunity they could to gain an advantage, and their efforts created an entire generation of experimenters and inventors who pushed boundaries of science and industry at every step, questioning tradition and established knowledge whenever they had evidence to back up their claims. And it remains so to this very day, half a millennium later and on a different planet. And finally, ever since first exiles came out of the gateway and realized their new homeworld isn't a deadly trap, they found in themselves something they thought was already gone, optimism and hope for a better future. As our people explored and expanded across Ortus, they realized just what luck they had. Sure, the planet wasn't a pleasant place to live on, but the life that we uncovered on and under its surface turned out to be one of Ortus's greatest assets. Herds of grazing animals, similar to our bisons, roamed the cold valleys, and while at first they seemed dangerous, in the end they turned out docile and were quickly domesticated. Caves turned out to be overgrown with edibles, not inhabited by monsters lurking in the dark. And as was mentioned before, even microorganisms inhabiting our new home turn out to be beneficial. All that combined means that our people look to the stars with renewed hope, eager to find out just what awaits us out there. With a bit of luck, we'll find something even more beneficial. However, you will note here that while we embrace those three ideas, egalitarianism, materialism and xenophilia, we are not embracing any single one of them above others, and most importantly, above reason. We may be supporters of democracy and ardent believers in personal freedoms, but that doesn't mean you can just do whatever you want. If your actions are dangerous to others, then, no matter how well justified, the state will put you down. We may be focused on material things, but that doesn't mean we've completely forgotten the value of immaterial. We still understand why morals exist, while stories and songs and art have value that can't always be described in currency units. And finally, while we are going to the stars with one arm extended in greetings, the other arm firmly grips a shield, in case our peaceful welcome is ignored. It is, I believe, this balanced approach that allowed us to get this far, and one of the most important challenges before our people will be to keep this balance, so that we don't lose ourselves in fanaticism. So, now for the government. Humanity on Ortus is divided into several nations that formed in early days after the Exodus, when long distances were a serious obstacle in terms of communications. Today, though, those nations are all united under Ortus Council of Nations, a political entity that works with representatives of all nations in order to chart a singular course for our entire race. Now, the Council began as an organization that conducted diplomacy between all nations in order to ensure that we won't have any large-scale conflicts on our new world, but over the years it became basically a world government that can, with enough votes, impose its will over member states, although usually the Council refrains from that, since it's not exactly what it stands for. Today, the OCN is a different organization than what it was, say, two decades ago. At first, it operated on regular rules of representative democracy. People voted for the party, and that party did what it thought was best. But that, of course, meant all the problems that old Earth democracies had, like politicians telling one thing during the elections and then doing something completely different once they were elected. Or it could lead to situations where one party won with such an overwhelming support that it could do anything without any oversight. But when the Innovation Party, led by Drahoslav Tesar, won the elections in 2190, they decided to shake things up a bit by bringing every single citizen of Ortus into their government. The party argued that, with new technologies, every citizen had a constant access to global information network, and as such could participate in all legislation processes. While in old days only those who sat in the council could vote, today every registered individual has a vote, and every time a new law is passed, the process is as transparent as possible, with public consultations available to anyone who needs them. The ruling party can no longer pass an unpopular law by voting secretly in the middle of the night, as everyone can see their hands and everyone has a chance to stop it. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that politicians are gone, they still exist, and to prevent chaos they are the only ones who can propose new laws, but the process of becoming a politician has been changed as well. Simply put, if you want to have a place in the council, you need to pass an exam. You need to know how states and societies work, and you need to be aware of current issues. No longer can a populist march into the council and say, "I don't like taxes, you don't like taxes, let's ban all taxes." By becoming a politician, you agree to hold destiny of others in your hands, and so you must first prove yourself as a reasonable person, in theory at least. Still, this means that our government is mostly promoting people based on their personal merit, which ensures that we always have the best of the best in important offices, which greatly increases the efficiency of state as a whole. As for the state's work, here's a quick rundown of policies currently implemented by OCN, just to paint a better picture of how life works under the Council's leadership. We'll start with an odd one, the military law. While all armed conflict between humans are strictly forbidden, space exploration prompted our people to form some sort of official statement regarding conflicts with other life forms. It is, of course, purely hypothetical. Chances of finding sentient life in space are astronomically low, but encountering one that would be not only sentient but also hostile and technologically advanced enough to pose a threat are just purely in the realm of science fiction. Still, the official statement is that, in case of encountering hostile life forms out there, we are allowed to take the initiative and go in guns blazing. But, and this is crucial here, only if we have no other option, for the official standing of the OCN is to always try to establish a peaceful communication, no matter how difficult it may seem, and to avoid provocations at all costs. If all that fails, then, and only then, we are allowed to bring out the guns. Next, we have the strategic stockpile law. In short, governments set up a limit of food that always needs to be present in emergency warehouses in case of shortages. We do not want the repeat of situation from early days on Ortus, where we lost millions to starvation. Currently, the limit is set relatively high, to prepare enough supplies for future explorers and hopefully settlers. So for now, all surplus food is bought by the state. Next, we have a set of laws that are just no-brainers, as they have no place in civilized societies. Things like slavery, purges, or resettlements are all forbidden, and while talking about them isn't forbidden, it is considered to be in a really bad taste. Then there are laws regarding unions. For most of our time on Ortus, unions were completely deregulated, like they were back on Earth, but now our government decided to put some limited restrictions on them. Nothing major, just a way to control them and make sure they won't become too powerful. Next, we have various economic laws, but there we try to strive for balance. Our market is open and free, and our people earn average sums of money in their jobs, and they pay moderate taxes, so everything kinda cancels out. The only bonus for our population is the fact that various consumer goods are mostly sold at affordable prices, which allows our people to achieve some decent life standards. The council also prefers a hands-off approach to private businesses, and as long as they don't pose a threat to the state or break any laws, they can expand however they see fit. When it comes to law enforcement, OCN uses its own enforcers that are operating outside national bounds. Now, this is rather unpopular amongst politicians, and the planet-wide police force is quite expensive, but the end result seems to be worth it, as crime rates are dropping and people are more content. There is also a minor law regarding religions. Mostly irrelevant now, but it still exists, and small but noticeable portion of our people find this law important. Basically, OCN guarantees freedom for all religious beliefs, as long as their tenets do not violate the law. Still, our current government is kinda against this, and so we always have an open option to just ban all religions altogether, although it could potentially destabilize our society. And finally, we have education laws. The council sponsors think tanks across the world, and pays for education for all citizens, regardless of age, as long as they wish to educate themselves. It does absolute wonders to our scientific efforts, but it seriously drains our treasury as well. But the hope here is that, as we discover more and more new technologies, that knowledge will offset the high costs of free education. We still have some time before we finish our spaceport, so since we've already covered the major things, let us turn our attention to a handful of individuals whose presence is vital to all our efforts. First, we have the man who sent us to space, Drahoslav Teza, leader of the Innovation Party. Originally an agricultural scientist in one of Ortus's universities, he often found himself at the forefront of various political discussions, and soon it turned out that, while he was very good at his job of genetically altering crops, he was far better at dealing with influential people who rule nations. He joined the Innovation Party when he was 27 and quickly became its most prominent member, and his active reformation campaigns assured their victory. Then we have Teza's second, Takumi Ishii. While Drahoslav is our head of state, in a way, Ishii is more of a prime minister, who oversees day-to-day governing and makes sure all little wheels are turning, so that massive wheels of state can move unopposed. He is, as you can see, a man of science, like most Innovation Party, and as such, his main focus is to boost our technological centers, so that our brightest minds could focus their attention on getting us to the stars. Now, those two are the main political power guiding us, but there's another trio that is just as important, that quietly walks in the background. I'm talking about the heads of our science divisions. At the top of physics division, we have Dr. Roman Poniewski, an expert in computing, programming and all things that require a bit of coding. The system our citizens use to keep tabs on the government and vote on various laws without too much a hassle is his creation. Next, there's Professor Adhira Tanwa, who is quite possibly one of the smartest people, if not the smartest, we have on Ortus. She leads the BioSoc division, and her intelligence means that no matter what project she works on, she'll have the results ready before the investors start asking where the research money went. And finally, there's Professor Nestor Lachino, a mind behind our rapid industrialization. His engineering division is a place where quiet, pragmatic people work to improve daily lives of humanity in any way possible. And in fact, the spaceport we're building in orbit is Professor Lachinov's brainchild. And speaking of that spaceport, it's finally done. After months of hard work, our construction crews have finished their work, and after grand orbital ceremony, the first human habitat in space is now officially open, thus starting the space age. For now, it will just have a skeleton crew, but as soon as all tests are finished, 100,000 people will travel to this installation to live and work there. And in fact, we will already begin expanding our port with professional laboratories, so our scientists could work in completely different zero-G environments. But before that happens, we still have one thing to do. One of the main components of our spaceport is a shipyard, which we can use to build true spaceships and launch them into space without the need for expensive liftoff systems, necessary when launching from the surface of the planet. Now, we have a few prototypes in mind, but we'll start with Tesla-class exploration ship, a floating laboratory that we can use to truly reveal the secrets of our solar system. It will take us some time to build it, and there is still much to do before it can fly into the void, but the first step has been taken. Today, we begin the construction of our first stellar traveler. Tomorrow, who knows, we may build a galactic empire. We will see what future holds in the next episode of Second Chance. I'll see you next week. Oh, and Merry Christmas.
All right, Doc, hit me. How bad is it?
Professor, and actually it all went well. Far better than anticipated, to be honest. It seems that interest in space travel is at its historic high right now. We have some conservatives around the place complaining about it, but their opinion is generally drowned by enthusiastic approval from the majority of the population. And the best way to prove it is to just look at the applications. Those 30,000 spots we had on the station disappeared literally within a minute.
30? Weren't the proportions supposed to be 60-40?
Initially, yes, but Lachinov said that, at least at the beginning, his artificial gravity generators will need additional technicians and logistics to make sure they work properly. And I'm inclined to agree with him on this one. Nestor is an ass, but he knows his machines. If he says he needs more space for his grease monkeys, then for everyone's sake we should give it to him.
Very well, but I assume that with this reduction your own project had to be downgraded as well. Are you okay with that?
Sure, there will be time for adjustments further down the line, and we only had to pull out 2,000 people out of the list. We'll just get them there as soon as there's an opportunity. Besides, those 6,000 selected ones should be enough for a start. Still, it feels wrong to do this, Chancellor. Telling people that spots on the station will be decided at random and then pulling several thousand tickets just to give them to people selected by the government just seems wrong.
I agree, Professor, but this is our first operation on such a large scale, and I don't want to leave anything to chance. Plus, I left that choice to you, and you're not part of the government, so everything's fine.
Sure it is. I don't approve, but I understand your reasoning. And in a way, those people will be like secret agents working for my department, keeping tabs on our first spaceborne society. Anyway, I have their dossiers here. You know, if you want to run them by some security measures I don't have access to.
Yes, I'll give them to my secret cabal of spies as soon as you're gone. Let me see here. A man who sells frost steaks from a cart in New Samarkand? Is this the right list?
Oh, you mean Ogoday? Yeah, the psych division figured out this one. This guy sells his food right at the junction between caves and the upper city, and despite having customers from both these places, no one ever shanked anyone near his cart. Apparently, he's just good at talking to people and can disarm even the most tense situation with just a few words and a bad joke. Head of psychology division was just bouncing with excitement when he heard about that one. He says that if we'll let him sell his stuff on some important crossing with tons of people moving around, he'll do more for the morale on the station than entire propaganda division.
I see, but wait, hold on. I pulled that file completely at random and you just gave me an entire backstory. Do you actually remember everything about those 6,000 people?
It's my job, isn't it?
Yes, but you have an entire department working for you and enough computers to store all that data.
Never mind. What I want to say is impressive work, Professor Tanwa. Our science division once again outdid itself. I wish I could say the same about the political side of things. I'm afraid we can't help you with that, Chancellor. Science is an organized and logical process, while politics is... well, it's not. But you could hire Dr. Poniewski to help out. Just point him at the opposition and tell him they're just dying to hear about his newest theory on quantum algorithms. Then leave them there for 10 minutes. Trust me, they'll agree to everything just to make him stop.
I appreciate the offer, but thank you. These last negotiations have to be dealt with very carefully, since we're going to ask them to act seemingly against their interests. But just think about it, Professor. For the first time in recorded history, we have a chance to completely unite humanity. Just think where we could go from there.